welcome back to the final segment of Business in Motion, a program that focuses on business and entrepreneurship from an Afro-centered perspective. I'm your host, RGL Biz Coach, and we will be wrapping up this lecture by William Agman. And again, it's entitled Everything You Need to Know About Financing and Investing, and it's all done in less than 1 hour. So I'll see you as soon as it's finished.
Allows you to control the business going forward. But because the company is now owned by public shareholders, you have to make sure their interests are properly represented. So you have to have a board of directors, a group of individuals who represent the interests of the shareholders, who have a duty to make sure that their shareholders are treated properly. And you wouldn't have the same degree of flexibility you had when you were a private company because you have other constituencies that you need to think about. Now, the benefit of the IPO is the stock would now be liquid. There'd be a market where it would trade in the public markets, and then over time, if I wanted to sell more stock, I could do so, or if new investors wanted to come in, they could buy stock, and our stock would now be liquid. It'd make me feel better about this business in terms of my ability to, at some point, exit, or if I wanted to raise more money, I could sell stock fairly easily in the market, because each day you could look up the price, either on the web or in New York Times or otherwise, and you can figure out what your business is worth. Okay, now, how does this matter to you? Now, the purpose of the example of our lemonade stand is just going to give you a primer on what companies are, what they do, how they earn profits, what the various reports they provide to investors so investors can figure out what they're worth. And the purpose of this lecture is to give you a sense of some of the things you need to think about when you're thinking about investing perhaps some of your own money, whether you want to invest in a lemonade stand, whether you want to invest in a company on the market. Let's assume at 22 you get a pretty good job, and instead of spending your money on gadgets or a fancy apartment or not so fancy apartment or going out and drinking a fair amount, you put some money aside and you start investing money. Let's say you could save $10,000 at 22 and you can earn a 10% return on that money between now and the time you retire. What would you have in 43 years? The answer is you put aside $10,000, you don't save another penny, and you invested it and you earn 10% on your money each year, you'd have $600,000 in year 43. And the reason for that is, well, in year one, your $10,000 would become 11. In year two, your $11,000 would grow by 10%. And so you'd be earning interest, not just on your original principal, but you'd earn interest on the interest you'd earned in the previous year. And that compounding effect allows money to grow in an almost exponential fashion. Now, obviously, if you earn more than 10%, you can earn even higher returns. Now, that's if you put $10,000 aside in 22, you'd have $600,000 in 43 years. That's pretty good. What if you had to wait until you were 32? The problem there is, by year 33, you'd only have $232,000. Maybe that's not enough to retire. So a key thing here is, if you're going to be an investor, it's really one of the most valuable assets you have today as someone who's 18 or 19 years old is your youth. You want to start early so that your money can grow over time. What if you could earn 15%? Give you a better sense of how powerful compounding is. Remember, at 10% for 43 years, you'd have $600,000. That's pretty good. But if you earn 15%, you'd have over $4 million. Now you're in a pretty good position. And so obviously, making smart decisions about where you put your money has a huge difference in what your retirement assets are. And obviously, if you put aside more than $10,000, if you could put aside $10,000 each year, then your wealth would be quite enormous. Now, just for fun, if you were one of the world's great investors, Warren Buffett being a good example, if you could earn 20% per year for 43 years, you'd have $25 million. Again, the original $10,000 investment would increase by 2,500 times over that period of time, just by earning a 20% return. Albert Einstein said the most powerful force in the universe is compound interest. So the key is start early, earn an attractive return, and avoid losing money, and you're going to have a very nice retirement. Okay, now let's talk about the risk of losing money. Now let's assume that in order to try to get a 20% return, you took a lot of risk, and it turns out that every 12 years, you lost half your money because you hit a bad patch in the market, or you made dumb decisions. Well, your $25 million at 20% would now only be worth $1.8 million in 43 years. So a key success factor here is not just shooting for the fences, try to get the highest return, it's avoiding significant losses over the period. Okay. So as Warren Buffett says, rule number one in investing is never lose money. And rule number two is never forget rule number one. So if you can avoid losses and earn an attractive return over time, you're going to have a lot of money in many, if you can stick at it for a long period of time. Okay, so how do you be a successful investor? Now, I'm assuming that you're not going to go into the business of investing. I'm assuming that you're going to be a doctor or a lawyer. You're going to pursue your passion, but you're going to have some money that you're going to save over time. And I'm going to give you my advice on the topic. It's not necessarily definitive advice, but it's what the advice I would give my sister, my grandmother, on what she should do if she were in the same position. I think that's probably the right way to think about it. So, number one, how do you avoid losing money? What are good places to invest? Well, my first piece of advice is, despite the story about the lemonade stand, I'd avoid investing in lemonade stands. I'd avoid investing in startup businesses where the prospects are not very well known. Because again, you don't need to make 100% a year to have a fortune. You just need to invest at an attractive return, 10, 15% over a long period of time, your money grows very significantly. So how do you avoid the riskiest investments? My advice would be to invest in public securities, invest in listed companies, companies that trade on the stock market. Why? Because those businesses tend to be more established. They have to meet certain hurdles before they go public. The stocks are liquid, so you can change your mind if you want to sell. If you invest in a private lemonade stand, it's hard to find someone to take you out of that investment, unless that business becomes fabulously profitable. So that's piece of advice number one. Invest in public companies. Number two, you want to invest in businesses that you can understand. What I mean by that is there are lots of businesses that you come in, that you deal with in the course of your day in your personal life, whether it's a retail store that you know because you like shopping there, or it's a product, your iPad, or that you know you think is a great product. But you have to understand how the company makes money. If the business is just too complicated, you don't understand how they make money. Even if they've had a great track record, I would avoid it. And a lot of people thought Enron was an incredible business because it appeared to have a good track record, but very few people understood how they made money. It was good to avoid it. Another very important criteria is you want to invest at a reasonable price. It could be a fabulous business that's done very well over a long period of time, but if you pay too much for it, you're not going to earn a very good return. The last bit is that you want to invest in a business that you could theoretically own forever. If the stock market were to close for 10 years, you wouldn't be unhappy. What do I mean by that? Now, again, if you're going to compound your money at a 10 or 15% return over a 43-year period of time, you really want a business that you can own forever. You don't want to constantly have to be shifting from one business to the next. And what are businesses that you can own forever? Well, there are very few that sort of meet that standard. Maybe a good example is Coca-Cola, right? What's good about Coca-Cola is it's a relatively easy business to understand. You understand how Coke makes money, right? They sell a formula or syrup to bottlers and to retail establishments, and they make a profit every time they serve a Coca-Cola. People are going to drink a lot of Coca-Cola for a very long period of time. The world's population is growing. They sell in almost every country in the world. And each year, people drink a little bit more Coca-Cola. So it's a pretty easy business to understand. And it's also a business that I think is unlikely to be competed away as a result of technology or some other new product. Right? It's been around long enough. People have grown used to the taste. Parents give it to their children, and you can expect that it'll be around a long period of time. I think that's one good example. Another good example might be McDonald's. You may not love McDonald's hamburgers, but it's a business that's been around for 50 years. You understand how they make money. They open up build these little boxes. They rent them to the franchisees. They charge them royalties in exchange for the name, and they sell hamburgers and french fries. And you know what? People have to eat. It's relatively low-cost food. The quality is pretty good, and they continue to grow every year. So I think the consistent message here is try to find a business that you can understand, that's not particularly complicated, that has a successful long-term track record, that makes an attractive profit, and can grow over time. So what are the key things to look for in a business, as I say, that lasts forever? Well, you want a business that sells a product or a service that people need and that is somewhat unique, and they have a loyalty to this particular brand or product, and that people are willing to pay a premium for that. I mean, another good example might be a candy business. While people are willing to buy generic versions of many kind of food products, you know, flour, sugar, they don't need to have the branded product. When it comes to candy, people don't tend to like the Walmart version or the Kmart version. They want the Hershey chocolate bar or the Cadbury chocolate bar or the See's candy. They want the brand, and they're willing to pay a premium for that. And so that's, I think, a key thing. You want the product to be unique. You don't want it to be a commodity that everyone else can sell, because when you sell a commodity, anyone can sell it, and they can sell it at a better price, and it's very hard to make a profit doing that. If you're investing for the long term, you want to invest in businesses that have very little debt. In our little example before, we talked about our lemonade stand. You know, there's $250 worth of debt. That didn't put too much pressure on the lemonade stand company, but if it had been $1,000, we hit a rough patch, the business could have got out of business for failure to pay its debts, the shareholders could have been wiped out. So if you can find a company that can earn attractive profits, that doesn't have a lot of debt, where they generate vastly more profits than they need to pay the interest on their debt, that's a safe place to put your money over a long period of time. You want businesses that have what people call barriers to entry. You want a business where it's hard for someone tomorrow to set up a new company to compete with you and put you out of business. I mean, like going back to the Coca-Cola example. Coca-Cola has such a strong market presence. You know, people have come to expect when they go to a restaurant, they can ask for a Coke and get a Coke. It's very hard for someone else to break in. Now, of course, there's Pepsi and there are other soda brands, but Pepsi's been around a long time. Coca-Cola and Pepsi have continued to exist side by side over long periods of time. So when you're thinking about choosing a company, make sure that they sell a product or a service that's, it's hard for someone else to make a better one that you'll switch to tomorrow. You also want businesses that are not particularly sensitive to outside factors, so-called extrinsic factors that you can't control. So if a business will be affected dramatically if the price of a particular commodity goes up, or if interest rates move up and down, or if currency prices change, you want a company that's fairly immune to what's going on in the world. And I'll use my Coca-Cola example. I mean, if you think about Coca-Cola, it's a product that's been around probably 120 years. Over that period of time, there have been multiple world wars, development of nuclear weapons, all kinds of unfortunate events and tragedies and so on and so forth. But each year, the company pretty much makes a little bit more money than they made before, and they're going to be around. And you can be confident, based on the history, that this is a business that's going to be around, almost regardless of whether interest rates are at 14%, whether the U.S. dollar is not worth very much, or the price of gold's up or down. Those are the kind of companies you want to invest in the long term, businesses that are extremely immune to the events that are going on in the world. Another criteria, if you think back to our lemonade stand company, as we grew, we had to buy more and more lemonade stands. And those lemonade stands only cost $300 each. But imagine a business where every time you grew, you had to build a new factory to produce more and more product. And those factories were really expensive. Well, that company might generate a lot of cash from the business, but in order to grow, you're going to have to just reinvest more and more cash into the business. The best businesses are the ones where they don't require a lot of capital to be reinvested in the company. They generate lots of cash that you can use to pay dividends to your shareholders, or you can invest in new high return attractive projects. I guess the last point I would make is that if you invest in public companies, it's probably safest to invest in businesses that are not controlled. A controlled company is kind of like our lemonade stand business that we took public. The problem with a controlled company, unless the controlling shareholder is someone you completely trust, unless there's someone that has a great track record for taking care of so-called minority investors, the non-controlling shareholders, it can be a risky proposition to invest in that business because you're at the whim of the controlling shareholder. And even if the controlling shareholder today is someone that you feel comfortable with, there's no assurance that in the future they might sell control to someone else who's not going to be as supportive of the shareholders of the business. So it's not that you can simply have a profitable business and a business that has done well. You have to make sure that the management and the people that control the business think about you as an owner and are going to protect your interests. So these are some of the key criteria to think about. Now, when are you ready to start investing money? My guess is you're a student, you probably have student loans, perhaps you even have some credit card debt, you're going to graduate, you're going to get a job. So you don't want to jump right in and while you have a lot of debt outstanding, start investing in the stock market. The stock market is a place to invest when you've got you have money you can put away and you won't need for 5 years or maybe 10 years. So if you're paying relatively high interest rates on your credit cards, you definitely want to pay off your credit cards first before you think about investing in the stock market. Your student loans are probably lower cost than your credit cards, but again, here, my best advice would be, if your student loans are costing you 6 or 7%, well, if you pay them off, it's as if you earned a guaranteed 6 or 7% return. And you're just better off getting rid of your credit card debt and even your student loan debt before you commit a lot of material amount of money to the stock market. Even once you've paid off your credit card debt, perhaps you paid down your student loans, you want to have enough money in the bank so that even if you were to lose your job tomorrow, you've got a good 6 months, maybe even 12 months of money set aside. Let's talk a little bit about the psychology of investing. So we've talked about some of the technical factors, how to think about what a business is worth. You want to buy a business at a reasonable price. You want to buy a business that's going to exist forever, that has barriers to entry, where it's going to be difficult for people to compete with you. But all of those things are important, and a lot of investors follow those principles. The problem is that when they put them into practice, and there's a panic in the world, and the stock market's heading down every day, and they're watching the value of their IRA or their investment account decline, the natural tendency is sort of to do the opposite of what makes sense. To be a successful investor, you have to be able to avoid some natural human tendencies to follow the herd. When the stock market's going down every day, your natural tendency is to want to sell. When the stock market's actually going up every day, your natural tendency is to want to buy. So in bubbles, you probably should be a seller. In busts, you should probably be a buyer. And you have to have that kind of a discipline. You have to have a stomach to withstand the volatility of the stock market. Key way to have a stomach to withstand the volatility of the stock market is to be secure yourself. You've got to feel comfortable that you've got enough money in the bank that you don't need what you have invested unless for many years. That's a key factor. Number two, you have to recognize that the stock market in the short term is what we call a voting machine. It really represents the whims of people in the short term. Stock prices are affected by many things, by events going on in the world that really have nothing to do with the value of certain companies that you invest in. So you've got to just accept the fact that what you own can go down meaningfully in value after you buy it. That doesn't necessarily mean you've made an investment mistake. It's just the nature of the volatility of the stock market. How do you get comfortable? You don't just buy a stock because you like the name of the company. You do your own research, you get a good understanding of the business, you make sure it's a business that you understand, you make sure the price you're paying is reasonable relative to the earnings of the company. Let's say this is just not for you. I don't want to invest, buy individual stocks. It just seems too risky. I don't have the time to do my own research. What are your alternatives? Well, your alternatives are to outsource your investing to others. You can hire a money manager, or you can hire a group of money managers. And there are a couple of different alternatives for a startup investor. The most common alternative are mutual fund companies. So what's a mutual fund? A mutual fund is a, I guess technically it's a corporation, but where you buy stock in this corporation and the manager selects a portfolio of stocks. So what they do is they pool together capital, money from a large group of investors. So let's say they raise $1 billion, and they take that money and they invest in a diversified collection of securities. Now the benefit of this approach is that with a tiny amount of money, you can even less than $1,000, you can buy into a diversified portfolio managed by a professional manager who's compensated to do a good job for you investing in the market. So mutual funds are a good potential area for investment. The problem is there are probably 7,000, 8,000, maybe 10,000 different mutual funds, and some are fantastic and some are not particularly good. So you need to do research to find a good mutual fund manager in the same way that you need to find individual stocks. So it's not just the easy thing of just investing in mutual funds. So here are a few key success factors in identifying a mutual fund or a money manager of any kind to select. Number one, you want someone who has an investment strategy that makes sense to you. You understand what they do and how they do it. They're not appealing to your insecurity by using complicated words and expressions that you don't understand. If they can't explain to you in 2 minutes what they do and how they do it and why it makes sense, then it's a strategy you shouldn't invest in. Number two, and this is not necessarily in this order, this is probably should be number one, is you want someone with a reputation for integrity. If again, if you're starting out, you probably want to invest in some of a mutual fund that's sponsored by some of the larger mutual fund complexes as opposed to a tiny little mutual fund that's privately by a mutual fund company that you've never heard of. There's some benefit in the larger institutions. You can be more confident that they're not going to steal your money. You want someone, an approach where the investor invests money on the basis of value. And now this sounds kind of obvious, but value investing has a very long-term track record. And now there are other kinds of investing, including technical investing, where people are betting on stocks based on price movements. But I highly recommend against those kind of approaches. So you want someone who's making investments where they're buying companies based on their belief that the prospects of the business will be good and that the price paid relative to what the business is worth represents a significant discount. You want to invest with someone that has a long-term track record, and I would say 5 years is the absolute minimum. And ideally, you want someone who's got 10, 15, 20 years of experience investing in the markets, because there's a lot that you can learn being a long-term investor in the market. You want someone who has a consistent approach, where they haven't changed what they do materially year by year, that they have a stated strategy that they've kept to thick and thin, that's enabled them to earn an attractive return over their lifetime as an investor. And I always say, in some ways, most importantly, you want someone who's investing the substantial majority of their own money alongside yours. You want someone whose interests are aligned with yours. If it's a mutual fund, you want them to have a lot of money in their own mutual fund. If it's a hedge fund, which is a privately sold fund for investors who have higher net worths, you want a manager who's investing alongside you as well. We started with a little lemonade stand company, and the purpose of that was to give you some of the basics in how to think about a business, you know, where the profits come from, what revenues are, what expenses are, what a balance sheet is, what an income statement is, how to think about what a business is worth, how to think about what the difference between a good business is versus a bad business, how debt is generally lower risk but lower return, how equity investors or investors who buy the stock or the ownership of a business have the potential to earn more or lose more. We use that as the basics to get some of the vocabulary to think about investing. And we talked about investing in the stock market. We talked about ways to think about how to select investments, how to deal with some of the psychological issues of investing. We covered a fair amount of ground in a relatively short period of time. Now, I entitled the lecture, "Everything You Need to Know About Finance and Investing in Less Than an Hour." Well, it really isn't everything you need to know. It's really just an introduction, and hopefully I didn't mislead you by induce you to watch this for an hour, but there's a lot more that can be learned, and there's some wonderful books that can teach you on the topic. But I think what's interesting about investing, whether you choose this as a full-time career or not, if you're going to be successful in your career, you're going to make some money. And how you invest that money is going to make a big difference in the quality of life that you have, and perhaps that your children have, or the kind of house you're able to buy, or the retirement that you're going to be able to enjoy. And we talked about the difference between a 10% return and a 15% and a 20% return over a very long lifetime, and what impact that has in terms of how much wealth you create over the period. So investing is going to be important to you whether you like it or not. And learning more about investing is going to have a big impact on your quality of life, if money is something that you need in order to meet some of your goals. I got interested when I was probably 22 or 23, I started interested in being an investor, and I read a book. I read a book called The Intelligent Investor. It was written by Ben Graham, and Ben Graham is a famous value investor. And it's kind of like reading Jean-Paul Sartre's essays on existentialism. You read it, and it either is an epiphany and it affects the way you live your life, or it's of no interest to you. And this was the equivalent, but in investing, I found it fascinating. And what I liked about investing is it was something very accessible even to someone who's 22 or 23. What's kept me intrigued is that it's one of the few jobs where every day you can study something new. You're constantly learning about new businesses, new situations, new management teams, new issues. So it's infinitely challenging. The world and the stock market are obviously very dynamic places, so the challenges continue. These same concepts, while they're useful in deciding how to invest your portfolio, they're also very useful to you in thinking about decisions like buying a home, making decisions in your line of work, whether to hire additional people. You know, these kinds of calculations and thought processes are helpful, and they're helpful in life, and I recommend that you learn more. Well, thank you for paying attention, and I wish you well.
And there you have it. Again, that's William Ackman. And again, that's entitled "Everything You Need to Know About Finance and Investing." And in essence, what you just heard or what you just received is a course in a box. It's been compressed to less than 50 minutes, but the information is so spot on. This is information that you really need to adhere to, and I hope you took very good notes. And I'll tell you, time is up. So make sure to follow me on Instagram at RGL Biz Coach, and also Instagram and Facebook at RGL Real Estate Pro, and Business Capital in Motion. Become a subscriber on YouTube to that channel. It's building up. The videos are starting to build up on that. So make sure to check that out. So same time, same place next week. We'll see you. Have a great week. Bye-bye.